positive results for workers of color at home, here, nationally and internationally. Today, obviously, in a few minutes, we're going to hear from our esteemed guests, but I want to put a small frame in it from my perspective. I realize that all the people that I have around me sometimes have some value. The workers know who I'm talking about. You know what I mean. Almost less than a month after President Obama was elected, the New York Times, which says it has the best news fit to print, and their magazine printed this. The end of the revolution. Castro, Cuba is turning 50. It's been dying for years. What can Obama do, or anyone else, to help bring the island into the 21st century? Those of you who like Outdoor magazine, their article was, "Cuba is dead. Long live Cuba." In Seattle, unbeknownst to many of us, the Seattle Times found some compassion. They wrote an article in their Pacific Northwest magazine called "Finding Cuba, Past Politics and Poverty, the Island Extends a Welcome Hand." The Nation magazine published a series of articles called "Obama's Last Chance on Cuba." Everything has to be so dire. Time magazine said, "What will change when the Americans arrive?" Newsweek, which now doesn't have a print copy, they're all online. Their article with a picture of Comandante Che says, "Viva el capitalismo. Is Cuba ready for a money shot?" This is supposed to be good journalism, but don't be laughing. And a production that I get every month from AAA, that's in case I get a black tire and the battery goes down, they wrote one of the best articles. It says, "On Cuban time, the doors are opening to stronger bonds with our island neighbors." I'm not going to send them a check, but I thought it was So we are here today to hear a perspective that I've heard now several times. No offense. I'm his chauffeur. I can almost do the presentation. But he has a wonderful presentation. He has a lot of passion. People say this, he's a young man, or he says in his presentation, he is a young man, 37 years old, vested with the values of the revolution. But most of all, from a political perspective, he knows the way I feel about him. He's a good comrade. And I think good comrades need a hand before they even start. Miguel Fraga, the first secretary of the Embassy of the Republic of Cuba.
Are famous for long speeches, but I don't like to break. I don't want to break any of Fidel's records. But I don't know why you put me now, and you said that you're going to speak again, so you're going to give me two opportunities to speak today. But it's my great pleasure to be here. I feel a lot of love today and all this week here in Seattle. I have been told that I am the first diplomat who came to Seattle since 1999, and it's a privilege to be here today. I made this presentation, sorry, I'm here again. I did the same with this man, this good friend, Bill. He saw the original presentation, because I always make change to the presentation, you know? And it's a privilege to be here. I'm going to do this. I always say that we are in the best moment in the last 50 years. between Cuba and the United States. But we don't want to wait another 50 years. Now is the moment to have normal relations between Cuba and the United States. Unfortunately, we've reestablished the diplomatic relations, but we don't have normal relations yet. And I'm going to try to explain why. And at the end, probably Tamara, Gary is going to help me to answer the questions, because as a Cuban diplomat, I'm not an expert in all the fields, you know? I am only a representative of my people. So please, be careful with your questions. Be generous with me, because I love my country, but I don't have all the information, you know? In any case, I can say that I'm going to give you my email, and after that I can send you the answers by email. No. Well, let's start. I'm sorry for my English, probably need to improve a little, but this is a good opportunity to practice. So, U.S.-Cuba relations, you can see there, you can see the Washington Memorial in Washington, D.C., and the Jose Martí Memorial in Havana. You can see how similar they are. And this is because we have a lot of history together, you know? These last 50 years, we don't have relations and we have many problems. We have a lot of history. And we share that history. Why not? So, let's start. I'm going to start with some opening questions. And the first one is, what do you know about Cuba? And I think this is very important. Every time I go and I ask to people, what do you know about Cuba? I have different answers. But the real issue is that the majority of people don't have enough information about Cuba. Sometimes people say, okay, you're famous because cigars, you're famous because you're wrong. I remember one student that told me, okay, I know I love Lucy. And I say, wow, you missed the last 50 years. That was a true answer, you know? And some people say, okay, Bay of Pig, the Cuban Missile Crisis, that was in the 60s. What do you really know about Cuba? And sometimes we have a lot of misinformation. Sometimes what you read in the media is not what we believe is the real Cuba. And I always say Cuba is beyond the headlines. And if you don't believe me, go to Cuba. So, would you like to visit Cuba? You can raise your hand. How many of you? Oh, wonderful. That's a wonderful support. Thank you very much. Now we are going to have commercial flights, probably it's going to help, you know? Do you consider that Cuba and the United States can have normal relations? That is another important question. And my question is, why not? What is the real excuse to not have normal relations between Cuba and the United States? Have you been in Cuba? How many of you? Okay, raise your hand. Excellent. Excellent. And this is for the end, probably. Do you consider that Cuba received fair treatment in the media? I'm going to present some information here, and in the end you can tell me if you read this before, if you know this before. Let's start. Why the Cuban Revolution? And this is very important. Why the Cuban people made a revolution in 1959? Why that happened? Why we changed everything in 1959, when we tried to change our way of life? And I have this quote for you. I believe that there is no country in the world, including any and all the countries under colonial domination, where economic colonization, humiliation, and exploitation were worse than in Cuba, in part owing to my country's policy during the Batista regime. I approve the proclamation which Fidel Castro made in the Sierra Maestra, where he justified the call for justice and especially yearned to write Cuba off corruption. I will even go farther. To some extent, it is thought Batista was the incarnation of a number of sins on the part of the United States. Now we shall have to pay for those sins. In the model of the Batista regime, I am in agreement with the first Cuban revolutionary. That is perfectly clear. You know who said that? You have any idea? Let me help you. October 24, 1963 was an interview for the New Republic, was published on December 14, 1963. President Kennedy. I would love to see that in the New York Times. And this is the man who approved Bay of Pigs. This is the man who dealt with the missile crisis. a year before 1963. And I always like to say, like to think, that because of the experience in Bay of Pigs, we avoid a nuclear disaster in the Cuban Missiles crisis. It was the men who understood the real situation in Cuba. And at that time, he was working to try to improve the relations between Cuba and the United States. According to the discovery channel, he was trying to do a coup in Cuba, I don't know. But what we know is that he sent a person to try to avoid more confrontation between Cuba and the United States. So I like to start with this. And all what I'm going to present is not Cuban propaganda. You can check all these numbers that I'm going to present right now in the World Bank website. So, unfortunately, since the 60s, the U.S. policy toward Cuba was trying to isolate the island. Unfortunately, through comprehensive economic sanctions, including an embargo on trade and financial transactions, the embargo is still there. The people believe, and some people believe right now, that we have no relationship with the United States. That is not true. The embargo is there. What we call blockade, you know, is there. And it's hurting the Cuban people on an everyday basis, you know. And, of course, United States President Eisenhower cut the relations with Cuba in 1961, January 3, 17 days before President Kennedy took office. 17 days before, we have the Bay of Pigs invasion, the Cuban Missiles crisis. By the way, I like to put this for the students. President Kennedy took full responsibility for Bay of Pigs. He said, it's our fault, we support this. And I like very much what his daughter, your current ambassador in Japan, said. And this is Twitter. I love Twitter. You're going to see a lot of tweets there because I love how do you have to put all your ideas in 140 characters. That is a challenge. And Carolyn Kennedy said, 52 years after the Cuban Missile Crisis, President Kennedy will be proud of what President Obama have reached out with Cuba. Well, Cuba, what is Cuba? 11.2 million of people. We are smaller than Pennsylvania. Our GDP, according to the World Bank, is $77 billion. Our per capita income is $6,000, according to the World Bank. You can check that. Always remember. Our life expectancy is 79 years old. Our birth attended by skilled health staff is 100%. Our mortality rate is 4 children per 1,000 live birth. 99% of our children have immunization, but teens, the 1% that don't have is because religious beliefs. 100% of the Cuban population is know how to read and write, and it's not only that, but the university, the majority of them. 95% of the Cuban population have access to improved water sources. 93% have access to improved sanitation facilities. We spend 12.8% of our GDP on education. According to the World Bank in 2010, that was the highest investment in education worldwide. We spend 8% of our GDP in health, and 4% only in the military. And this last is not from the World Bank, this last sentence. To health and education was allocated 53% of the total expenditure of 2014 budget activity. According to the United Nations, we are number 44 in the Human Development Index 2014 out of 187 countries. And with all this, I always say, it's not fair to compare Cuba with the G7 countries. Put the GDPs of those countries and our GDP, and you're going to see that it's not fair to compare. But even when you compare with these numbers, we are very, very many things to show, you know? But if you compare Cuba with the rest of Latin America, Africa, some countries in Asia, you're going to see what this means. And sometimes that is what people understand when they go to Cuba, because they read a lot. But when they go there and see and compare, they know the truth, and they can understand what is Cuba. I love sports, sorry. Sport fun. So this is Cuban Olympics. Before the revolution, almost nothing. One man, Ramon Fong, won, I believe, 4 of the 5 gold medal before the revolution. After the revolution, everybody talks about Cuban and sports. You know, you only need to see our ball players here in the Mayor Lakes. The only ball players that have to defect from the country if they want to play here, because they have to sign a document that say, I'm not going back to Cuba. I'm not going to bring back money to Cuba. Why? Because they are Cubans. The only country in the world. So, something interesting. I found this in Twitter, in NASA, the other day, January 29. Happy birthday to Arnaldo Tamayo Mendez of Cuba, first Latin American and first person of African ancestry in space. We are proud of that, you know? And people say, okay, but you're talking about, you know, the 60s, something that everybody knows. What now? What do you have to show now? Let me show you this. According to the World Health Organization, Cuba is the first country in the world to receive validation for eliminating mother-to-child transmission of HIV and syphilis. We receive one award. We receive one award for that here. Our Minister of Health went to Washington to receive that. It's something that we are proud. We share that with all the people that support Cuba. Well, this is important also. Our key trading partners export Venezuela, Canada, Netherlands, China, imports Venezuela, China, Spain, and also Brazil. So we are doing business with all the countries in the world. I remember one person that told me, okay, people here in the United States worry about their investment in Cuba. How is it going to be? I say, to the Canadians. Question about that? They have been doing business with us for many years. If you want to talk in Spanish, go to Spain. Well, we are not isolated anymore. Cuba has diplomatic relations with 191 countries, orders, and institutions. 190 of the 193 United Nations member states. We have 114 foreign diplomatic missions in Cuba, and we have 122 Cuban embassies and missions abroad. That is a huge number. You can check that with many countries, and you're going to see that we are almost all around the world, and we have almost all the embassies in Cuba. That is a huge number. Of course, sometimes a Cuban embassy is a house with a flat, and two people inside working hard. We don't need millions to have an embassy abroad. Well, we are very proud to say that Cuba fulfilled the Millennium Development Goals of the United Nations, and we also are proud to say that we share our solidarity with all the countries in the world. And these are numbers that you can see. More than 300,000 collaborators have provided service in 158 countries. Today, even when our doctors don't have good wage, we have 50,000 Cuban healthcare workers providing service in 68 countries. And we are proud of that. Mm-hmm. Some people say, okay, you send doctors to Venezuela because of the oil. And I always say, why we send doctors to Haiti? Why we send 400 doctors to fight Ebola in Africa? We believe in solidarity. And what we have with Venezuela is solidarity. They have oil, and they provide oil not only to Cuba, they provide oil to all the nations in the Caribbean and some of the nations at a good price. And we have the doctors, and we share doctors with them. And by the way, I want to remember today President Hugo Chavez. Well, since today, yes I can, and this was before President Obama, by the way. Educational program, more than 9 million people have left illiteracy behind in 30 different countries. More than 68,000 students from 157 countries have graduated in Cuba. Some of them are from the United States. As you can probably know, we train doctors, students from the United States, and the idea is we cannot afford to send doctors. All the countries around the world is expensive, so what we're trying to do is to find people who wants to come to Cuba, become a doctor, and go back to their communities. That is how are we held? By the way, this was the New York Times. In 2014, for the first time, we read something interesting. And he said, this is an editorial. Cuba is impressive role on Ebola. Cuba has a long tradition of dispatching doctors and nurses to disaster areas abroad. In the aftermath of the Hurricane Katrina in 2005, the Cuban government created quick reaction medical corps and offered to send doctors to New Orleans. The United States didn't take Havana up on that offer. I remember, I don't know if you are aware of that, but that happened, that was a real story. And we offered the doctors, and some people say, okay, this is politics. Unfortunately, after that, we offered one South doctor to come to help the Orleans. And after that, we had, unfortunately, the earthquake in Pakistan. Pakistan asked for help, and we sent the 1,000 doctors to Pakistan. At that time, we didn't have diplomatic relations with Pakistan, but they asked for help, and we sent the doctors, and we are proud of that. This is from my Twitter account last year. I put this because you commemorate the 10th anniversary of the Katrina, and I don't understand why you didn't know this. You offered the doctors. And this was what Fidel, our former president, said in September 19, 2005. There is nothing strange about the behavior of Cuba, which did not hesitate to offer the people of the United States the immediate dispatch of experienced doctors with essential resources needed to administer emergency care to people in mortal danger following a serious natural disaster. Also, our country was closer to the area hit by the hurricane and was in the position to send over human and material aid in a matter of hours. We do the same on September 11, 2001. We offer our airport for you. Probably you didn't hear that before, but we offer our help. Well, the last year, let's go. Breaking news, December 17, 2014, President Obama and President Raul saying that they're going to start working to reestablish diplomatic relations. And I like to say, the world don't come to an end after that. Nothing bad happened, we are here. And you can see our national newspaper, Grandma, we publish both the speech, President Obama and President Raul in Spanish for all our people to read what they said. The real news was the return of the five to Cuba, as you can see there. Sense to the solidarity of you. Thank you. And after that, why December the 17th? And now I'm going to start something that some people don't like. But I have been told that you like the polls. You want to see what people say, what people believe. And I have a lot of polls that shows that the Cuban Americans wants better relations with Cuba, wants to travel, wants to have business with Cuba. And these are the two first that I want to show you. It's taking 1 minute, probably they don't like the polls. Thank you very much. This is solidarity. Well, things stop. I don't know why. Well, I have the first poll. It's the Atlantic Council. It's the Atlantic Council. And they say that the majority, that this is in February 2014, so month before the announcement. And they say that the majority of Americans wants better relations with Cuba. And I also have one poll from the Florida International University. And why Florida is so important. We have 2 million of Cuban Americans living here. 1.2 million live in Florida. And the majority of them are in Miami-Dade County. And they say, and I have the numbers, but unfortunately I don't know what is stuck. And they say that the majority of them want better relations with Cuba.
It's like the relationship.
Don't call my, stop the comments, you know? Do you want to do any question so far? Do you have any question?
Why don't you just tell us the information?
Because I have a lot of information. I want to show you the numbers, you know? Well, here you have to use the polls, you know, you have to present the polls and say, it's not me, it's not Cuba. You know, read this, and every time they say, okay, okay, I have enough. Well, now you can see both, one from the Atlantic Council and the other from the Florida International University. And after that, those poll out before the December 17th, and the first after that was the Washington Post and ABC News. And they say, okay, the majority of people are agreed with President Obama and President Raul. They want to establish diplomatic relations.